Good afternoon, I'm City Councilor Mary Ann LaBarge, and I want to welcome you to the Committee on Social Services, Veterans, Cultural, and
Recreation.
And Recreation. I would like to introduce City Councilor Gina Louise Scherer from Ward 4. And to my left would be Alyssa Klein, who's the councilor from Ward 7. She's going to be a little bit late, but she will be attending. And I'm City Councilor Mary Ann LaBarge, Chair. I would like to call the meeting to order. And I also would like to announce that this meeting is being videoed and recorded by NCTV. Approval of the minutes.
So moved.
I would like to make an amendment on number 8 on July 20th. City Councilor Mary Ann LaBarge spoke about upcoming agendas for September and October. I would like to make a motion to amend the minutes by adding Jeff Harness, which I did talk about him, from McCooley-Dixon Hospital coming, so that's the only amendment. Okay, so the amendment has been approved. All in favor?
Aye.
And I would like to introduce Jeff Harness. He is the Director of Community Health and Government Relations at the McCooley-Dixon Healthcare. Jeff, welcome to our committee, and you're welcome to go ahead and do your presentation.
All right, thank you. So the presentation is called Getting to Healthy, which is a play on words. The getting part has to do with transportation, the healthy part has to do with healthcare. And let me give you just a little bit of background.
Hi,
I'm Jeff. Nice to meet you. So I'm just getting started. You haven't missed anything. Presenting on Getting to Healthy, which is this report here.
This is Jeff Harness, Alyssa Klein,
Councilman. The hospital conducts a health assessment every 3 years, which is actually my second point. And we do that because the Affordable Care Act requires us to do that. It's part of the IRS regulations now, so we conduct the health assessment and we identify the results that are most important to the communities that we serve, and then we identify practices, strategies, actions, programs that we might be able to implement or encourage others to implement or pay others to implement to try to improve the situation. So that's how we got to this report on transportation, which I'll be talking more about. But the other reason we do a health assessment is because healthcare is changing. Currently, the current model, and for the last maybe 40 or 50 years, the model has been called fee-for-service. So what that means is you have some injury or illness, you break your leg, whatever happens, you come in, we treat you, and we bill your insurance company. So in other words, we don't make money unless something happens to someone. And that model is beginning to shift, which I think is a really positive thing. And it's shifting towards outcomes and not just providing the service. So that means we'll have an incentive once this shift has fully happened to we'll have an incentive to focus on prevention, focus on making sure everybody in our population has access to care, and really try to do a better job at coordinating care so that we see people in the hospital less often. That's the end goal. That will take some time for that shift to fully happen. So jumping down to the third slide, community engagement to identify needs and establish priorities. We understood from some survey work that we did that transportation was an issue and health access was an issue that we should pay more attention to. So we convened groups at the Amherst Survival Center at Cooley-Dickinson Hospital and in East Hampton to help us understand these priorities a little bit better. And people confirmed that yes, we should work on transportation and we should understand it better, and we should see if there was some way we could improve access to care through transportation. when you think about transportation to care, though, you have to understand in healthcare, we really are trying to think more broadly than just healthcare itself. We're trying to think about all the things in life that you need to be healthy, whether it's getting to a supermarket, getting to your job, visiting friends, and obviously, yes, getting to your doctor. But it's a pretty broad range. And when we thought about how overwhelming that task is, we decided to narrow it down for this version of the report to getting to healthcare. But before I get into that, some other priorities that we identified, just to kind of give you a more comprehensive view of what we're doing. We identified behavioral health as an issue we wanted to work on. And with partners, we mapped out the current system. And we identified some things that we can do now to try to improve coordination. One of the early things we're working on is stigma and working on anti-stigma. So for example, on October 15th, we have a physician from Mass General who will come out and speak to our community about stigma. And stigma works at two levels. One is it makes it difficult to get a funding stream and get insurance companies and the legislature to be interested in more support for mental health. But it also works against people who have a mental illness from wanting to seek care because they're concerned that stigma will come back and harm maybe their future employment opportunities or their friends and family will look at them differently. So we're trying to address that. We're also working in collaboration with other hospitals in the Pioneer Valley, in fact, all of them on a behavioral health anti-stigma project that will unfold later in 2015 or early 2016. Another priority was within health access was Latino health access. Even though we have the Affordable Care Act, we have Chapter 224 in our state, we know that there are people in our community who aren't fully getting access, even if they are on paper. The system isn't fully working for them. And so we are working with Casa Latina to help them implement a pilot patient navigator project. And so we're going to be working with them to study that, find out how effective it is and what changes we might make. But you know, the point is that Latinos now have a person at Casa Latina who can help them navigate the healthcare system. Because you know, we know it's pretty complicated. We focused on East Hampton for some of our projects because data told us that East Hampton has higher than we would hope rates of death from cancer and heart disease. Every community will show death rates of cancer and heart disease as their top two. But East Hampton, the pattern looked like it was just higher than surrounding communities. And we felt that tobacco was probably the leading reason for that. And we felt we might be able to stimulate some action on that. So we've been working with the East Hampton Health Department, the City of East Hampton, the School Department, and some nonprofits to get some projects going on those issues. So we hope over the course of time we'll see lower cancer and heart disease rates. Youth substance abuse prevention was identified as a priority, and we're supporting local coalitions and schools to implement the prevention needs assessment survey, which was completed and those results are now available. What we didn't know when we developed priorities was that opiates would suddenly emerge as a major priority. So that also fits in there, not just youth, but more broadly. People in our county are dying of heroin and other opiates. And I think 11 so far this year have died in Hampshire County, 11 in Franklin County, plus Apple. And that rate's actually projected to be down just a little bit from recent years, which is the good news. But we know that there's an enormous amount of work to be done. So that emerges as a priority during the year. So back to transportation. We developed a project with the United Way of Hampshire County and the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission. As I noted earlier, this topic is way bigger than any one institution can tackle, you know, unless you're a state or federal government, but way bigger than a small community hospital can tackle. And certainly we don't have enough money to cure the problem, but we felt that what we could do is study the issue with our partners and put out a report to stimulate thinking, identify new partners who might have creative solutions, and hopefully over the course of time put together some initiatives that would improve transportation or, well, I'll get into some other thoughts about how we can lessen the need for transportation a little bit later. So this project, like I said earlier, the initial focus is on healthcare, but as we're talking, just keep in mind that it really is much broader than healthcare. So the communities are listed in terms of primary and secondary service areas. Primary means that most of the people in that community choose Gilead Dickinson for their care. Secondary means that it's less than most. And that would vary by community. But, you know, maybe between like 25 and 50% or something like that. So a substantial portion, but not everybody. So we, again, with our partners, conducted gap analysis. And we tried to understand how people are getting to Gilead Dickinson Healthcare, meaning hospital. Later, we could focus, you know, on a separate project, we could focus on how people get to doctor's offices or whatnot, but this particular study was the hospital itself. And so we looked at all those ways on the left, you can see from car to ambulance to taxi to paratransit, and tried to study that. The Pioneer Valley Planning Commission developed this map for us. You can see the green shaded part in the center, which is where Gilead Dickinson is located, so that's Northampton. And so the farther out you get, the longer it takes to get there, no surprise. But basically, we just wanted to understand how long it's taking people to drive to the hospital. So this GIS map gives us some sense of that. And I can't see the times from here. You have them in your reports. The orange at the far extremes of the map show about 60 minutes. It takes about an hour at the extremes. And then obviously, the closer you get, you know, it's easier. When you think back to the primary care service map, about 20 minutes is about how long it takes most of the people in our primary service area to get here, which isn't too bad, as long as you have a car. Not everybody does, right? So for folks who don't have a car and have to take a bus, this is where things get pretty interesting. So we learned, for example, that East Hampton, and where's East Hampton around here?
Fourth one down.
Yeah, so the mileage is 6 minutes. It takes 11 minutes by car. And now look at the column that says transit time. It takes 80 minutes. The reason for that is you come into from East Hampton into Northampton. You get off the bus at the Academy of Music and then have to switch sides and then come back up Route 9 West. And so that trip takes you about 80 minutes. So as you can imagine, just a hypothetical case of, let's say, a single mother who's a waitress with a child who needs to come in. Get on the bus, 80 minutes in, have your procedure or exam or whatever, 80 minutes back out. That is a significant portion of your day. And that's just East Hampton, which is only 6 miles away. We heard anecdotally stories from Sunderland and places like that where people are going to pretty extreme bus rides just to get to the hospital. So, you know, that's not easy for anybody. But if you add to that, maybe somebody has a disability, or by definition, if you are coming to the hospital, you're probably not feeling at your best. And so to have to navigate buses in that situation is a burden for people. The third bullet down, most communities in the service area don't have fixed route transit. So think of the hill towns, think of Chesterfield or, you know, any community up in that area where getting transportation to medical care is a challenge. The Hilltown Community Health Center is there, but if you need to get to the emergency department or come in for a CAT scan or something like that, it's not so easy to do if you don't have a car. So the gap analysis also looked at paratransit, and it's available through Pioneer Valley as well as Franklin Regional Transportation. Not a lot of trips for that, and we don't fully understand why that is. We know that most senior centers and councils on aging offer some level of transportation services. Usually there's some sort of volunteer pool or van or something that allows seniors, especially low-income seniors, to get access. But when you're seeking rides to volunteers, it can be a little bit subject to the whims of who's available, you know, who's willing, is there money to reimburse people for mileage, that sort of thing.
Okay.
They also looked at bicycles and pedestrians, so the main hospital campus is pretty accessible by that. So there are several taxi companies in the area. for a while there, the taxi companies seem to have dried up, and that was a little bit of a challenge for our patients for a while, but there seems to be some more options now. But if you live farther away, as we looked at that earlier map, it can get pretty expensive. You know, a cab ride to Leverett, I'm going on right here, but I think it was like $40. So if we're discharging somebody from the emergency department and they don't have a way to get home, sometimes we will just get a cab. And, you know, we pay for that because the patient may not have any other way to get home. If they have family or friends, we try not to go through that avenue first because sometimes this doesn't work out. But, you know, we have to kind of put a lid on that because $40 is a lot of money.
Did you find that people would take ambulance service when they might not have really needed to because they don't have transportation?
Yeah, I've heard that anecdotally. I don't think this particular report got into that. So I can't really answer your question. We didn't really quantify that. But I've heard anecdotally from relatives who are EMTs elsewhere, not here, that people sometimes will do that because when you call 911, they have to pick it up.
They would just call an ambulance just to transport them?
People sometimes do that because it's a way to get where you've got to go. It's obviously not a good idea for anybody watching on TV. Don't do that. Because, you know, it's really unfair. It ties up an ambulance rig that other people might need. So it's, you know, it's not really cool to do that. We know that there are some local medical practices that do offer transportation services to the clients, and I don't remember specifically which ones do that. I don't believe it was primary care. I think it was a specialty, like it was maybe like eye appointments or eye surgery or something like that. Kind of going on anecdotal memory though. So the gap analysis, looking at access to care, we identified some best practices and put them in these four categories that we felt were worth exploring more to see if we could reduce the need for transportation and or improve transportation. So one thing is technology. So think about a future where we're using telemedicine or telehealth to work with people who maybe are in their homes. Now we do that already by telephone. So the Visiting Nurse Association will call you and talk with you on your phone. So that's an example of telehealth. Now extend the technology to video. It's only a matter of time before a primary care visit could occur through telehealth. That's not going to reduce or eliminate the need for transportation, but it's going to reduce the need for some trips. Because people will maybe have their smartphone, maybe they'll have a way to send in their weight or blood pressure or other things that need to be monitored so that the primary care office can just do regular monitoring. So here's an example of how that might work in the future. It's not working this way yet. If a patient has congestive heart failure, oftentimes weight gain, which is water retention, is a warning sign that their medications need to be adjusted and they need to come in. So through using a smartphone and weighing themselves every day, the technology would send the report right to their physician or nurse practitioner. And if that person gained, let's say, 4 pounds over the course of 24 hours, that would be a warning sign that something was wrong and it was an urgent issue. The current practice is they would probably have to come in and maybe have a bag of Lasix on to get the water, water retention dealt with, and go back home. In the future, it would be ideal if maybe an ambulance crew could hang that on a pre-911 basis. And so that would prevent the need for the emergency trip into the emergency department. And obviously that would be more comfortable for the patient and it's cheaper for the system. So that is not what we can do today. But that's the sort of thinking that we want to have. You know, so the report was designed to stimulate thinking about creative ways that we could use technology to reduce the need for transportation. Time will tell. There are issues around reimbursement, credentialing, people's comfort level with technology. So it's hard to say how quickly that will happen. I'm sure there are some consumers who are ready now to do that. I'm sure there are some consumers who probably won't feel comfortable with that anytime soon.
The Jeff, wouldn't that, say you have somebody with a heart problem, an elderly, or whatever age they are, but they've never dealt with technology, who would be training them to use that?
Yeah, so I think that's going to be an issue in terms of people's level of adopting technology. No matter what age you are, there are people, I have an 85-year-old aunt who's very comfortable with technology. I have a younger relative in his 20s who's really not as much. So I think it's maybe not so much about age as it is a certain comfort level with technology. And the issue with technology is not only using the equipment itself, it's also just feeling comfortable with a visit that isn't face-to-face or hands-on. Some people are way more at ease with the video, you know, the role of the video screen than others are. So I think, you know, the goal would be to, over time, roll that out, and for people who are ready for it, great, they have that option. For people who don't want to do that, you know, fine, you've got your regular primary care or specialty care.
Look what they've done with technology, with the Coumadin testing. I mean, a lot of people don't want to go on a weekly basis and have their finger pricked or needles shoved in their arm. So now they have a machine, right? It's costly, but it's worth it, where that machine will take that reading and shoot it right off to like Valley Medical.
Yeah, I actually didn't know about that equipment. That's an example of using technology that cuts down the need for one more trip to the Coumadin clinic. So let me move on. Land use planning, co-location services. Now, this is probably some ways off, but an example in some ways is our new Atwood facility, which combines a lot of services at one location, or at 170 University Drive in Amherst, which also combines a lot of services at one location. So you've got the lab, you have radiology, you have primary care at one site. What those service or locations don't do is co-locate with shopping or places that you've got to take the bus anyway. So that would be ideal down the road to think about how to locate services where people can literally have one-stop, you know, services. But something like that will take a long time to, you know, to fully move into that. Moving healthcare providers versus moving patients. Now the VNA already does that. The VNA will go to your home. At this point, not too many local physicians are doing that, but it's still one of those ideas that came up that we wanted to explore a little bit more. And you never know, you know, what extent that could happen and save patients who are homebound or who are just, you know, pretty ill from having to travel. Another idea that we have been kicking around is transferring knowledge to other people who are already interacting with patients. So, and again, this is a hypothetical example, but think about the Hilltown Elder Network or Meals on Wheels or a group like that that's already seeing people in their homes. Perhaps people in the future could be trained on monitoring blood pressure or maybe ask just some very basic screening questions that might identify some issue earlier. So all this can be explored, and we're, you know, in the early stages of thinking about how we could be creative and not just relying on cars and buses all the time. So when you add all those things up, you see all those arrows moving in the same direction towards improved access and improved outcomes. I don't think I have any more slides. I'm trying to keep this in short. I have a few more. This is just an example of a project, I think from a different country or a different part of our country. New Mexico, there's Project Echo, where moving the patient to moving knowledge. So that's an example of what I was just talking about. Rural Pennsylvania, they're talking about high-tech doctoring, be more outcomes-oriented. Again, we see some of the high-tech equipment. Again, I think the question, how do you buy the equipment? If you can't afford it, does that mean, you know, you just can't use it? Or does the hospital provide it? We haven't sorted through anything like that. It's really way, 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 you know, too early in the process to nail that down for, you know, more of a public presentation. Looking at our area as a whole, we are very healthy. The Robert Wood Johnson Foundation and the University of Wisconsin's Population Health Center have a project called Roadmaps to Health. They are the ones behind the county health rankings. And Hampshire County was identified as the 12th healthiest county for children in the United States. And for adults, we're the fourth healthiest county in Massachusetts, which is an overall pretty healthy state compared to many of the other 50. So we're very fortunate that we do have a healthy population. However, when you look beneath the surface a little bit, you can find that there are people who don't have the same level of access and the same level of health outcomes. And so we really do want to focus attention on the most vulnerable people to make sure that they're getting the same level of care and opportunity that everybody else is. So the United Way part of this project was to conduct surveys and focus groups and interviews. And so they engaged the categories you see on the screen. Putting the patient in the middle, with the doctor, the hospital relationship pretty close to it, other medical needs a little farther out, and then lastly, the ring that supports it all and holds it all together is a healthy lifestyle and community connections. So really, people need all those things to be working well for them to have a healthy life. You know, if you can get to a job or get to visit family and friends and just be part of the community, that's going to go a long way towards helping you lead a healthier life. But ultimately, most of us at some point or another do need to interact with the doctor and hospital. So we've really tried to focus this particular project on that. And there were 372 people that responded to the survey. So we're not going to try to argue that it was a randomized survey, you know, but on the other hand, we think it still tells us something. Members of the target population, with five bullet points or so that you saw, there we go, report being four times more likely to struggle with transportation as the overall population. And so that's no surprise given who we were targeting, you know, the elderly, people with disabilities and whatnot. And yet four times is a big number. There were 47% of that group report that lack of transportation has affected the quality of their healthcare experience. And we have some anecdotal stories about that, which I can share with you. Over half have missed appointments as a result of transportation challenges. And as you can imagine, as a healthcare system, a missed appointment means that someone else who needed that appointment couldn't get to it because the slot was full. It also means the doctor can't bill for it. So it's just better for everybody if we can get people where they need to be, when they need to be there.
Do you have a comparison number for what the percentage of missed appointments is at the hospital?
Yeah, I don't, but I'm fairly certain it's much smaller than that, way, way smaller than that. Do you have any sense of that?
Way smaller.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I don't know the number, but it would be significantly smaller. And 81% report that transportation difficulties make it difficult to do healthy things, just as buying fresh food, exercise. So I noted on the East Hampton example, or the Sunderland example, that one appointment really can take the whole day. We've heard some stories of folks from Amherst bringing the bus in, again switching at the Academy of Music, going down to Atwood for a physical therapy appointment, being done with the appointment, having to wait for the return bus, which comes up from Holyoke, back to downtown Northampton, switching buses and back to Amherst. And by the time you have your appointment and you've done all the buses, you're talking several hours. You've really taken up a substantial portion of the day. And if that's an appointment that you need to have a couple of times a week, or even every week as a physical therapy, you can see that it's a tremendous barrier if you don't have a car. For some people, that can lead to missed work, which means missed pay for some people. It can lead to school absence for children, even for things that are really pretty routine, like physical therapy. So it is a barrier. But I wonder if it was one of those days I didn't have time to look through this ahead of time. So these are some just quotes from the United Way survey and some focus groups. I know if I didn't have a car, it would be impossible for me to make my children's appointments. Taking the bus makes it nearly impossible to go grocery shopping. There's no public transportation in the hill towns. It's a huge barrier. You know, so things we know, but when people from our area are actually sitting down and telling us these stories, it has a little more impact. So I would encourage you to skim through that report and look at some of the other examples. Here's an example from someone riding the bus where getting in or out of the van or the vehicle is challenging if they're a little bit unsteady on their feet, and it's time consuming for the PVTA vans because they've got to pick up a lot of people. Drivers are reluctant to help, which you kind of understand. I think they're probably trained to be careful about to what extent they get involved in medical stuff. So, you know, no matter how you look at it, it's just it's a challenge for some people to get around. Here's one which I thought was an interesting perspective, and I don't think we anticipated this. Doctor is always run late, which makes asking for rides difficult. So you can imagine if you're asking family or friends or neighbors to take you, and the doctor's 45 minutes late, you feel like it's a big imposition, and you're reluctant to ask again. So it just makes it harder. It exacerbates the problem. This is a story United Way to Learn from talking to someone in Amherst. They talked about having to borrow a friend's car. The mother rides a bus into town, gets the friend's car. And I suppose she has to do it at a time when the friend's car is available. Drive back home, pick up her son, bring him in for an appointment. Drive back home, drop the son off. Go back to Amherst, drop the car off, and then take the bus back home. So, this is probably one of the more extreme examples, but it's real. You know, this is really somebody's story of what they have to do. And from what I understand, it's not a one-time trip. It's actually a trip that has to happen with some regularity. These are all in your handout, and I don't really need to go through them in too much detail. The four potential strategies that we talked about earlier. We just have a section on benefits, challenges, and then some comments about what that would be like to actually implement that. Is it okay if I go over these in detail?
Yeah.
Okay. But it will give us a few minutes just to read some examples. If anybody pulls this up on cable, do they have access to this presentation? For that reason, should I read it? So this example is bringing care to the patient. So an example would be a healthcare professional traveling to the patient's home, providing mobile care through specially equipped vans or other vehicles, healthcare practices traveling to places where patients are to gather, creating a satellite office of a healthcare practice, and then training, the last one is training non-healthcare professionals to provide basic evaluation or care as it's appropriate and practical. You know, so there are some benefits and some challenges to that. The benefits would be it's easy for patients, could potentially allow for earlier detection and treatment and follow-up. Challenges might be patient confidentiality. Accreditation training of non-health professionals could be a long process. We talked earlier about using technology. Some examples of that would be video appointments via phone or computer, or possibly satellite video conferencing. Benefits could be that it would be inexpensive for patients. Challenges would be the need to address reimbursement issues. And a couple of health plans now offer some level of telehealth reimbursement. So that's slowly starting to change. As we were talking about earlier, there may be some older adults who may be uncomfortable with technology, although I would extend that to say any age group. The fourth one, transferring knowledge of the specialist to primary care providers with the goal of mitigating the need for trips to hospital. A benefit of that would be the shift from having to move patients to actually moving the knowledge so the patient is less burdened. The challenges are that it's time-consuming and it's a slow, long process. We're making some progress on that with respect to mental health, where there aren't enough psychiatrists to see people in a timely way. So we now have a psychiatrist who's available to our physicians, our primary care physicians, to consult with. So the primary care doctors might be making decisions about medication, but they now have a psychiatrist they can talk to, just get advice about what that would look like. One of the goals, hopefully, or the outcomes, hopefully, with that would be that patients are more stable and don't go through periods of time without medication, which is unfortunately the time where people start to decompensate and end up in the emergency room. So that's the only been in place for the last couple of months. But, you know, we will see how that goes. So some next steps. And these are fairly recent. As of August, we provided a small grant to the City of Northampton Department of Planning and Sustainability to work with the Mass in Motion project, which, if you're not familiar with, I can say a little bit about it. Are you familiar with it? So Mass in Motion is a project from the Massachusetts Department of Public Health, and they provided a grant to the City of Northampton Health Department on behalf of other municipalities. I believe Williamsburg, Amherst, and Belchertown are the other partners in this project to try to improve healthy eating and active living through, in this case, complete streets, which means getting streetscapes that are more walkable, pedestrian-friendly, safer, paying attention to things like curb cuts, paying attention to things like intersections. I think an example of how this is not working would be the major intersection of King Street, Damon Road, and Bridge Road, where if you're trying to cross that intersection, you know, good luck. It's really tough. But through redesign efforts, and this will take time as roads are reconstructed, but through redesign, you can design them in a way that's more pedestrian-friendly. It just feels safer. You can figure out ways to slow cars down by street design. And so what the Planning and Sustainability Department will do is develop a complete streets guide that over time can be used for future sidewalk repair, road construction, just to inform how those things are designed. And that guide, once it's available, will be accessible to other communities in our area. So we think it's a great investment for a small amount of money. We talked earlier about the Hilltowns and older people. We've given a grant to the Hilltown Community Development Corporation to work with rural councils on aging to further study and improve transportation to healthcare for seniors. I don't think that's going to be easy to solve, but there is momentum, and they have other grant money besides ours to try to address that, and it's a pretty serious need. So we're going to give it a try and see if we can patch together some creative ideas. And then lastly, a small grant to the Amherst Survival Center. They have a small health clinic staffed by volunteer physicians, but it's difficult for them to get follow-up appointments with their patients, or to get their patients to follow-up appointments, is a better way to say it. So that small grant is added to a larger grant they have, which will help them to use cabs or, you know, other methods to get patients where they need to be for the follow-up.
So, Jeff, the Cooley Dick gave out 3 grants?
Yeah, as I said earlier, we conduct a health assessment every 3 years, and then we develop projects. We partner with other agencies, and we provide some money for projects either that we take on, or we can sometimes offer grants to projects that are in alignment with our priority areas. So we're going to be going through a health assessment process again, starting now through about a year from now. And other priorities may emerge, or these may reemerge as priorities for the following 3 years. But we'll be going through this process every 3 years, just to make sure we're always paying attention to priorities that are based on community need, lots of community input, just trying to follow that path. So we're really getting the right need and the timing the right way.
So these are follow-up appointments that aren't happening at the Survival Center, or are they?
No, so let's say somebody at the Survival Center is seen by one of the volunteer doctors, and let's say they're starting to show some early signs of diabetes. And the doctor's concerned about that and wants them to meet with an endocrinologist. But the patient can't come over here easily because maybe they don't have transportation, maybe for whatever reason the bus is not a great option for them, or you know, for whatever reason, it's just it's a challenge to get them here. This money is a pilot project to see if we can get that person in more quickly. And as you can imagine, you know, creating an appointment with a specialist doesn't always happen overnight because they're in demand, they're busy. And so trying to match up the appointment with the ride, all that can be a barrier. So this is just a way to see if we can experiment a little bit and see if we can get more quick follow-through for those patients. And if we can, that would be a good example to for the survival center and us to put in maybe a larger grant to a foundation. So maybe we can parlay that $700 into larger funds. You know, we realize $700 is not going to go very far. It's not going to cure everybody's problems. But what it can do is highlight the problem and show some examples of how we could solve it. And then if we hopefully work and get lucky, we can find some, you know, some bigger sources of funds. So I guess that is it for me. Any comments, questions?
Yeah, I know when we had the training or the seminar on this, that PBTA transportation was there, and both Pat Shaughnessy and I had mentioned how we have several meetings with PBTA because of the difficulties that people had with that transportation. Another issue that came up during the meeting was the difficulties people were having from Northampton to go to Hatfield. And that was brought up.
Yeah,
and
so
it's still a problem.
It is still a problem. Let's explain for anybody who's watching and also for everybody here what that issue is. Hatfield doesn't have a contract with PBTA, so buses don't go into Hatfield. At the same time, we have a orthopedic practice that's located just over the line in Hatfield. And so for patients who need a follow-up orthopedic appointment, and they need a, I may get the terminology wrong, but I believe it's a PT1 van, the PT1 van won't go to Hatfield. So those patients are going to Springfield, which is really pretty crazy because of just the extra distance. So, I think I was talking, you and I were talking about having a follow-up meeting.
Yes,
and trying to explore that more. Because if we could solve that, that would be really,
that would be
huge. Yeah. Not a lot of people are affected by it, but for the ones who are, it would be enormous. Yeah. So, you know, the meeting that you're talking about where we released this Getting the Healthy report, that was in March, we had 40, 50, 60, something like that, people there. And we are slowly but surely following up on things and trying some pilot projects. Transportation is going to take years to solve.
Oh, definitely.
And this is an issue statewide. Certainly in our region, it plays out a little more dramatically because we're rural. We have fewer options than the eastern part of the state. But you know, beyond statewide, this is a nationwide problem. It's a challenge everywhere you go. So. I think if we can all figure out how to pool resources, pool ideas, be creative, even if we can't solve the problem entirely, we can hopefully benefit it for some of the folks who need our help the most.
We also have an increasingly aging population, so
yeah.
We're going to have even more demand, I think.
Exactly.
People when we're starting.
I'm waiting for the era of the self-driving car, so when I'm too old to drive, I'm just gonna say to my car, driving a cooling system.
Will there be another update on the one that we had in March? When will there be another follow-up?
Yeah, I don't know. We don't have firm plans for that. I think from this report and from that meeting, there are so many actions to take that I think our roadmap is pretty clear for the next several years. So I suppose at some point we're going to realize we've actually made progress and it's time to circle back and and explore it again, but I don't think we're anywhere near that point. Could be several years away. So thank you for inviting me.
Thank you for coming. Appreciate that.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Nice to meet you too.
Do you want to stick around?
Yeah.
All right.
Is there another?
Can we
turn
the light on?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mommy,
turn on. So
there's another presentation around.
Where is it?
Questions or that you'd like to talk with Jeff about? Jenny Louise, is there any questions that you
No, I think
thank you very much.
You're welcome.
I would like to introduce Betsy Shelley Jensen. She's a PhD, DCM director, a Positive Place director, Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Council at the Cooley Dixon Hospital at Long.
Hi.
Welcome.
Nice to be here. Is there a way to be more cozy, or do I have to be on the TV? Is that it?
Oh, I mean the irony is just your back on the TV. you're welcome.
Wow. I know.
I'm just gonna invite Jeff and just all sit here and talk about. Sure. I don't have a PowerPoint.
Jesse, grab a chair and bring it right up here.
Okay. Right. You want me to sit here? I'll be happy.
And since Jeff has already been introduced to the counselors, I would like to introduce Gina Louise Shearer, counselor from Ward 4.
Hi.
And also to the left is Alyssa Klein from Ward 7, counselor, and City Councilor Marianne Barge from Ward 6 and Chair. So, that's it. I know you have some presentations to do for
us. Well, I have some information to share on what we're doing at Cooley Dickinson and really open to some feedback. I didn't bring a PowerPoint presentation, but I am the Director for Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Council at Cooley that was created a little over a year ago, last June. The new CEO and President, Joanne Marcusi, actually sort of gave birth to the momentum for it to begin. When she came to the Pride March, I guess it was in May or June, already a year ago, not this past one, but the year before, when she first came on board here, and was really excited to be in the contingent for Cooley Dickinson, was really excited to see the community. She was just here in March in the parade. And then was having a conversation, I believe, was the story with a colleague from back east in Boston. And he said, well, if you need any help around some LGBT health improvement plans or patient satisfaction or anything around that, just give me a call. And she said, well, we're in Northampton. You know, we're not going to need any help around that. And sure enough, after a few weeks here and a month here and another month, she realized that maybe, in fact, we could use some help. No matter the community that we live in, to improve our patient satisfaction, to improve access, and to really focus on some health equity issues. Not just for LGBT patients of ours, but for a broad range of populations which maybe don't get the best services, or we don't focus on, leukemia, or whatever. So we started a council that's made up of a senior executive sponsor, and a number of leaders at the healthcare corporation, which would include the VNA, the hospital, and some practices, and frontline staff. A mix. We tried to make sure that we were at least as diverse as the patient populations we serve, which we are not yet, which I think is the case in a number of the institutions here in the Valley, in education, and in housing and employment. We are striving toward that. Striving to make sure that our council is as diverse as the patients we serve. We have three aims that we're focusing on, and that is to diversify our workforce and our governance, which means our leadership and our board of directors, our board of trustees, to both reflect the patient population served and to leverage diverse talent. I think people are sort of very accustomed to hearing the word diversity and maybe even a little tired of it, have diversity fatigue, if you will. Inclusion sort of ratchets up the idea of creating a diverse and welcoming environment to include people from all backgrounds, with all ages, all abilities, all nationalities, religions, etc., to actually be decision makers. So it's not just bringing people in who look different, who speak a different language, who maybe use assistive devices at the frontline level, at the service entry level, but to make sure that we are really mentoring and coaching and bringing people up a pipeline for leadership, bringing people in at the leadership level, and really reflect the wide diversity of people that we serve in the valley, both at the workforce level and the leadership and governance level. So that's a big priority, and I can talk to you about some of the the strategies we're using to get there. A second aim of our triple aim is, I think we all have sort of fatigue of the cultural competence, increasing our cultural competence, enhancing our cultural responsiveness to the LGBT community, to people of color, to people with disabilities, etc. But we really can't continue, and we know we can't continue, to treat all patients the same. There's a visual I'm thinking of. I don't have the PowerPoint, but I'm thinking of a visual. The way when we have a sort of mind frame that we want to treat all our patients the same, which in some ways we sort of do, in one level of the ball field. But there's a vision of a fence and three little kids looking over the fence watching a baseball game. And one's short and one's medium and one's tall. And to make this, to treat everybody equally, we each give them the same level box to stand up on. And yet that little kid still can't see over the top because he's not quite as high, not as much access to resources, opportunities, etc. And so we don't want to just treat all patients the same. We want to learn about our patients' cultures. We want to learn about their values. We want to learn about their sexual orientation, their gender identity. We want to learn about their race and ethnicity and who makes decisions in their family. What does this illness mean to you and how do you go about healing and who's involved in your healing, etc. So we want to enhance our cultural responsiveness to diverse patient populations, which will increase our safety and our quality of care, and that's sort of demonstrated across the nation in the work that people do around cultural competence in healthcare. It also increases patient satisfaction and employee satisfaction. All of the research demonstrates that patients just feel more comfortable with folks who have the same background, speak the same language, maybe look like them, or have something in common, some connection to them. So patient understanding of what's going on with their health from the medical point of view, their trust in a provider increases when we become more culturally competent. They adhere to a medication regimen much more because they understand why they're doing it in their own terms and their set of values. Or they negotiate with the provider. Well, in my culture, we do this. Can I keep doing that? Well, sure, but let's also do this at the same time. And try to find that middle ground between cultural worldviews in order to heal. So we increase patient satisfaction. We actually improve our health outcomes. People who come to care are retained in care, understand and enter our dialogue with their providers, have better health outcomes. They're healthier people. We reduce the cost of the overuse of the emergency department, for example, and I don't know if you talked about that at all in your conversation. But there are so many advantages to enhancing our cultural responsiveness to diverse patient populations and learning how to do that, both for patient satisfaction, employee satisfaction, and safety and quality. And then the third tier of our triple aim is to eliminate what we call health disparities based on race, based on ethnicity, based on ability, based on your sexual orientation, language, gender identity. Jeff was saying that, we're one of the healthiest communities, in Massachusetts, and probably whatever it was, number four for kids. 12 for kids, that's pretty impressive, but I betcha if we take a look at different populations in our community, we're going to find that's not the case. And I can speak as director of A Positive Place, the AIDS service organization for Hampshire County, which I also direct, that when I first came on board and I take a look at, how are we healthy, living with HIV, and one of the best indicators of that is if you have an undetectable HIV viral load. And so they took a look, and they took an aggregate of everybody who came to use our services, and we have all of their numbers, and we can see their CD4 counts and their viral load. We look incredible. 96% of all of the people who come to us and who we can retain in medical care get to their appointments by driving them, co-locating with the infectious disease doctors, some of the very things that Jeff was talking about. We look pretty darn good. 96% have an undetectable viral load, which is great compared to the Massachusetts and compared to the nation. I think it's, you know, what could it be, 50-something, 60% nationwide people have an undetectable, 30%, sorry, it's a difference. 30% of the population of people who are diagnosed with HIV have an undetectable viral load. So at 96, we thought we're pretty good. But then we sort of focus in our lens a little closer at the people who are most at risk at getting HIV and at transmitting the virus, the communities, not just individuals that are at highest risk, gay men, bisexual men, and other men who have sex with men are at the highest risk. African-American gay men, Latino men, and HIV drug, heroin injection drug users. So when I took a look at African-American men, to take a look at their undetectable viral load, African-American gay men, those numbers increased. You know, we have, oh my God, we had maybe 45% or 50% of our African-Americans have, African-American gay men have an undetectable viral load. So when we sort of zero in and take a look at populations where we have data and where we keep data, we can actually use that data meaningfully, and it can make an impact on where our resources go, where we spend more time with our case management. If we're going to have a subsidized housing unit, which we have available to folks living with HIV, the next time one becomes available, we're going to give that housing subsidy to somebody with the highest acuity level. So we know that there are disparities. I think Jeff did a pilot project, he knows of a pilot project also done at the hospital in the mammography or radiology department, only to find out, not surprisingly, that Latino women are not screened as often as other folks in our community. If they're not screened as often for breast cancer, we're not going to find that. We're not going to be able to have early detection, and we're going to have higher you know, death rates as we see across the nation. And so that's just, you know, some examples of where we see what we call health disparities based on race, ethnicity, sexual orientation, and gender. So we have these three aims. They're huge aims. That's sort of our mantra that the council sort of is founded upon. And we've started a number of projects, all of which speak to each of these sort of three triple aims, if you will. Our biggest initiative that we've sort of been working on for a year now is improving our LGBT healthcare and health access for everybody in our healthcare system, especially considering the population of the valley here, and who we want to make sure we're keeping as healthy as we possibly can. I don't know how many of you use any healthcare system, but when you go in and you have to sort of fill out a form, you fill out some demographic information, right? And oftentimes you'll fill out and it'll say, male, are you female? You know, is this your age range? Is this your income? You know, maybe what's your primary language? Have you ever filled out a healthcare form that asked for your gender identity and asked for more than male or female? Mm-hmm. Have you ever seen a healthcare form that asked if you were transgender male or transgender female? No, not that you recall.
I just filled out one for my children and it was on there.
Yay! Where'd you go?
Northampton Area Pediatrics.
Good. Excellent.
It wasn't on there for the parents, but it was on
there
for the child.
But it's on there for the kids. Interesting. We'll get there. One of the things we realize we have to do is we have to get to know our patient population. We have to start asking people about sexual orientation and gender identity the same way we ask about race and ethnicity and primary language, or we're not going to know who our patients are. We know that LGBT populations is at risk for certain diseases more so than others. We know that lesbians are not getting preventive screening for things like breast cancer as at high rate as straight women.
Why is that? I don't get that.
I don't know the reason, you know, I haven't heard about the why of that, but we know across the board that that's the case. And I'm wondering if in our Happy Valley, if it's the case that some lesbian members of our community are not getting screened. Just as there, we found that Latina women were not getting screened at the same rate. So we know that, and we know that HIV, you know, the highest risk are for gay and bi men and men who have sex with men. So we know that there are certain diseases.
Yeah, but their doctors would say to them, you know, you need to have your mammogram done.
Maybe the doctor would say that, but would somebody necessarily follow up on it? Would a doctor say that maybe? Who knows? We don't know what doctors are saying. We hope doctors might say that. But one of the things that we're trying to do for our LGBT healthcare is we're trying to begin to collect data on who our patient population is. Mm-hmm. And we want people to feel welcoming and included. I think some of the visuals that we've recently included with some of our advertisements and our public awareness about, you know, the Mass General Cancer Center at Cooley Dickinson includes maybe two women. And so we could assume, well, maybe this is a lesbian couple. But we also want to be much more intentional about that. We want people to feel included. We want them to feel that we understand their family relationships and their partners. And we want to be much more intentional. And so we need to begin to ask questions of people from the get-go, from the entrance. Mm-hmm. So we will be collecting sexual orientation, gender identity information. It's going to take some time to implement this. We will be training people on how to do this sensitively. It's not something that people are really embracing wildly yet. I remember the days when we first started asking people about race and ethnicity at the hospital and other healthcare situations, and people were very timid about doing that as well. But we know that there are disparities in health based on race and ethnicity now, because we don't just collect the data and say, oh, this percentage of the population uses us. We can now say, well, this percent of the African-American community in our catchment area uses our healthcare system, and we see, you know, this disparity here. We see a prevalence of this. We see the ED wait times are longer. We see the pain management not at the same level that it is for white counterparts. Whatever it is we might find, we don't know. But we're going to be doing the same for LGBT community. So we will be collecting data. We will be training staff on why we want to be focusing in on LGBT healthcare and why it matters. If there are disparities among the LGBT population, health disparities, if we're not as welcoming, if we're walking around saying, where's your wife? Or, you know, where's your daddy? And somebody has two moms. You know, we really have to come along with the times. So, yeah.
Just something that I find really interesting. I used to work in HIV and AIDS back in the late 80s, early 90s. It's been a long time, but right around then, there was finally recognition that you couldn't just say to people, you know, are you gay or are you bisexual? And that's how the concept of men who have sex with men, MSMs, we used to call them. I don't know if that term is still
what we call MSM.
But there was finally recognition that it's not about the little box that you put people in with a title. It's about behaviors.
Right.
And so there is a way in which, yes, we need to define who our communities are and how people self-define whatever, but I think we still can make a lot of presumptions about what their practices and behaviors and who they hang out with and what they do are not necessarily fitting into our you know, healthcare providers' little categories. So for instance, and I'll use myself as an example and full disclosure here, people will, you know, there are these boxes, and sometimes, you know, I'm asked, and there's never a box that really defines my sexuality. But if I'm pushed, I'll come up with one of them. But that actually has no, it doesn't reflect the sexual practices. So, you know, I just think that, you know, as we continue to strive for inclusion and understanding our populations and all of that, I feel like we still have so far to go. And every time I fill out little boxes on sheets, I think about that it's not enough to just find the definitions of people. It's about...
And that just starts the conversation. I mean, a little bit of what it does is it helps us collect data so that we can track patterns and trends in healthcare. another thing it does is it starts the conversation.
Yeah.
I mean, it should, especially for at-risk populations for HIV, start a conversation about, you know, a comprehensive sexual history. I can't remember what the phrase is, but what is it? Talking about sex is often, do you remember that quote? It was awesome. It's harder for us to talk about it and to normalize sexual behavior than so many other things that we talk about with our, you know, with our healthcare providers. But it's something that we have to normalize. And as you probably know, in the world of HIV, that's what we talk about all day long. We're constantly, you know, you'd be surprised, you know, walking by our offices sometimes, some of the conversations that you would hear and some of the new phrases that you would learn and practices that you might not have heard about. But we have to normalize this because this is people's lives and this is their pleasure and this is who they are. So it just opens up that conversation a little bit.
And so much of it just seems like it's about training the healthcare providers
exactly. How
to actually feel comfortable
right.
and talk about this stuff.
Because
it's not enough to get the definition.
Right.
They have to be able to actually talk to you
right. And
not make presumptions because
right. It's
more comfortable and
right. Safe
to not.
So a big prong is going to be the education and training piece. And we have been partnering with the Fenway of Boston, Fenway Institute. That's pretty much considered a national expert around LGBT healthcare practices and educational enhancement programs. So we've been partnering with them. They've been doing a number of presentations and slide sets with clinical providers, with our administration. And we're probably going to be moving into we're going to be using them to do a train the trainers for clinical providers and sort of figure out who we can train with the Fenway that can then sort of move us through and continue ongoing education around LGBT issues, around protocols for, you know, what pronoun do I use with this transgender person? Where do we put a transgender male when they come into in the patient room? We have policies that we need not only to revise, but we need to develop. We didn't even know we needed a patient room policy around transgender care when the inpatient's in the hospital, but we do. And then we have to get people to understand that policy and to adhere to it. So we'll be doing policy revision and education. We'll be collecting the data. We'll be engaged in conversations at different levels. We'll be inviting members of the community to help us figure out some of this work and what we can be doing better. Part of the community needs assessment that Jeff and the team at the hospital are doing on behalf of the Healthy Communities Committee that we have to do every 3 years. There's going to be a section on LGBT health. And because, you know, that's just one of our initiatives. We know that we need to be doing better amongst Latino patients. We know that we need to be doing much better amongst African-American community members and neighbors. So we're going to be sort of targeting that needs assessment and some of our outreach towards pockets of our community that haven't felt as included as really they ought to have in the past to do that. We'll try and change our marketing and our visuals. So that's one big project that's been sort of been planning and getting going for a full year, starting with an assessment at the hospital amongst all staff about where we think they are, a community presentation where we got feedback from the community.
How much feedback did you get, Sharon, from the community?
There were 70-ish people,
yeah,
60 or 70 people at a community dinner with Dr. Harvey McAdon at the Fenway came and gave a really, you know, a good talk to the community, and then the next morning at 7:30 he gave his medical grand rounds to our clinical providers. And people were eager and interested. The questions were really good. The feedback, I think, at the community presentation were not surprising, and they were well heard. And we will be following up on a lot of those, which are also just best practice. You know, there are a lot of places. MGH is, you know, busy doing some of this work, as is the Fenway in Massachusetts. So we don't have to reinvent the wheel around any of this, but we do want to involve our local community members and stakeholders in this, and we will do so. I just want to say that, and I'm running out of time, the LGBT...
No, that's okay.
You know, our focus on LGBT healthcare has been our biggest focus, but we also are working to improve the patient experience for patients living with autism.
Yes,
and we have a small working group of people who are working on a very targeted project to make the experience from home to the ambulance to our emergency department a little smoother. And again, to, you know, begin to train some of the folks in the ED. EMS has already been trained in supporting people with autism through ALEC trainings. We're going to try and get some of those trainings into the ED. We have a new pod, a behavioral health pod, that we're designating to be a quieter, more calm place for behavioral health, but we're thinking we'll also use that for some of our patients with autism and others who just need that quieter space. And we'll be training folks on what are some of the signs to look for, how do we communicate, as well as preparing families to have, you know, like a one-page acute care plan. This is my child, or this is my family member. When he or she is flapping, it means this, it doesn't mean this. So we're working toward that, and that project came out of a larger project out of Mass General Hospital that's going on statewide. A number of Mass General Hospital affiliates are really working to see how we can improve that experience.
Well, that's a huge field, autism.
Yeah, it's a big field. There are a lot of people who are working with key stakeholders in our community who have been working at Peace because there was nobody working on it here. But now we've got our own local working group to see what we can do. We are working also somewhat along the same lines just to improve our access and our care for people with a broader range of disabilities, as you know. Through the forum that we have, which I think with you as well. We will be doing a much broader survey, as I said before, through a place called the Disparity Solutions Center, which is an affiliate of Mass General, to again assess where we are in terms of our patient care, our readiness, our welcome, our inclusiveness, and, you know, equity for by race and ethnicity and language and ability, et cetera. So much broader than the LGBT. We started with that because that's our community, and, you know, it's our biggest community, most vocal and visible community here, but we know we have more work to do with other populations.
I'm really just concerned about Latinos, women, joining and finding that many of them don't come in and get married.
Well, that tells us
Well, to put it in perspective, we don't want to overstate it and say that most don't.
Right.
But I will say there's room for improvement, a lot of room for improvement.
There's a bigger improvement thing?
There is certainly room for improvement. There's outreach that can be done. That just needs to be targeted.
Mm-hmm.
So there's definitely an opportunity. I'm pretty hopeful.
There's outreach and relationship building, I think. Yeah.
Well, that's where I feel Casa Latino could do some outreach there.
Absolutely, they have the patient navigator project with us, and we talked to them about these results, so I think it's solvable.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's fine.
Interesting.
Yeah. We have diversity dialogues monthly at the hospital that began last
fall, in December. Talking about the lunch
things? Yeah, so lunch forums, diversity dialogues, whatever we're calling them. That Jeff and another member of our patient and family advisory committee sort of co-facilitate, and everybody's invited, you know, through a big announcement through the hospital and the VNA hospice. It started, you want to talk a little bit about that?
I think this started in reaction to, I want to say the Ferguson, Missouri, where the young black man was shot by police. And people just had a lot of feelings about it, a lot of reaction to it. And we realized we didn't really have a place to give staff to go and talk about it. So we created this kind of spontaneous idea of let's just offer a place. Anybody who wants can come in, we'll bring the lunch, come in and sit in this room and we'll talk about it with a couple of people who are facilitators just to make sure it's constructive and, you know, appropriate. And it seemed to be popular. So we asked, should we do it again? And people keep saying yes, we keep doing it. So we've been doing them, not every month, but most months, for about a year.
For a while there, it was sadly focused on black men being killed by white police officers. And we've had some other topics as well. We've talked about where do we, you know, put a patient who's transgender. We've had a lot of conversations about, well, a patient will come in with a, you know, sex identified at birth or assigned at birth as a male, and yet has to be called a woman presenting as a female. And we need, you know, people don't know what to do, so they're sort of seeking support. So we've had informal conversations around that. We'll be viewing a video around having discussions around, after viewing a video for people who are deaf and hard of hearing. Just get conversation going, just get people talking about some issues. So
is it purely voluntary for staff, anybody who wants to come to help? Positions and right. Clinical staff and things?
Mm-hmm. So, targeted recruitment and retention of diverse workforce and government. Improved cultural competency for a broad range of folks in our multicultural value, and achieving health equity for everybody. We really are three main goals. We're doing a lot of different projects together. It's going to take a while. As for the transportation piece,
how's the targeted recruitment going?
The targeted recruitment has started. You know, as I said, we're just getting moving now. We've been doing a lot of planning. We have expanded one of our largest recruitment sites, and we also became a member of what's called the Institute for Diversity of the American Health Association, which allows us access to a national-wide recruitment search system. So we're pretty excited about that. We also have people who've been coming in lately into the area, know people from here, know people from there, so we have a sort of broader network of folks bringing people in. But we've expanded what we currently use. We're going to change our visuals. We are going to target, you know, there's no reason why we can't put ads into the Rainbow Times, even if we already are a monster. You know, but just make ourselves known and get people comfortable with our name and our presence. So we'll begin to do things like that. Any other questions?
Any questions?
Yeah, 2 minutes.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for being here.
Sure.
Really appreciate
that.
Thanks for staying,
Jeff.
Yep. Beginning and ending
with you.
Beginning of the day and the end of the day.
Hmm?
Beginning and end.
Yes, I'm sorry.
Thank
bye-bye.
You.
Thank you for the peace out.
Put it
off.
Is that your jacket?
See you
on
the 29th? Yes.
Yeah.
That's your jacket.
Looks
like
you. Yep.
We'll see you again. Bye. Bye-bye. Bye. Did you walk away? Thank you. City Councilor Alyssa Klein and Gina Louise Scherer will speak about the agenda for the month of October. So either which one of these.
I've got sort of the second half, so I don't know if you want to, you want to go chronologically, if you want to start.
So we have Phil Carman, the executive director of CESA, coming in, and I think he said he'd come between 5 after and 10 after 4, so it'll give us a little bit of time to do our regular business, and he'll speak for about 25 minutes, I think.
I thought he was scheduled to 5.
I don't think so.
Yeah, because on your email, it's at 5. And he agreed to that.
And you remember better than I do.
Well, in that case, I don't know, maybe I should try and move someone up. Because, so Una Koi, who's the, she's a founder of Town Farm and founder of the Tuesday Market, is coming. I'm not sure if anyone else is coming from the Tuesday Market. So she's coming at 5 to talk about the market. And I said specifically, they have a program where staff benefits are doubled at the market, so I thought we definitely want to hear about that. So she's coming at 5, and then Clem Clay, who's the executive director for Food Northampton, is coming at 5:30. Yep. So,
thank you.
Yeah, I'd have to check back. It sounds like you remember that Phil committed to speaking till 5.
I looked at the email this morning.
Okay, because for some reason I had some recollection that he
because you told him something to the effect that he can take all the time that he wants and so forth versus doing a screen presentation.
Yeah. I mean, it might be useful to have people come in a little bit earlier. I'm not sure he's going to need almost a full hour. Mm-hmm. But either way, I mean, if we have it set at 5
if the other ones are in here, we can meet them up.
It sounds like they want to, I mean, Una was asking for a specific time, so I'd like to give her a specific time.
Okay.
But it might be that I could say 4:45, that would be fine for her, but I don't think she,
I'm not sure. Yeah, there's a company that way, then if that's what Phil said, I just don't know off the top of my head.
Okay, thank you both very, very much. Any new business?
No.
That's it.
Move to adjourn?
Second.
Favor?
Aye.
Okay.